Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
So nice to see you all here today to help us celebrate our children and their Bible school experience. I just got to tell you, we had a week that was just wonderful. And I think you'll see that as you see the pictures and you hear the songs and experience Bible school for just a little bit this morning. I know it won't be worship like you're used to, but that's okay. Every once in a while, we need to change. We need to kick it up a notch. Before we begin worship, though, I would like to make just a few announcements. The flowers this morning that you see amidst food and balloons are given by Jill, our secretary, in memory of she and Terry's anniversary, which they would have celebrated this Tuesday. So, you know, have a special thought for Jill on that day, because it's going to be a hard week for her. I'm going to be on vacation. It's a working vacation. I have to go to Vermont and do a memorial service for my aunt. And in my absence, you'll see on the back of the bulletin, it says to contact Donna in case of any emergencies, and she can contact me as necessary. Okay? Are there any other announcements that need to be made at this time? Okay, then I need my Bible school kids to come on up here and let's do food truck party, okay?
Thank you.
God, we believe that you gave humanity life and that you gave Adam and Eve every good thing to eat in the Garden of Eden. Provided manna and quail for the nation of Israel as they wandered in the desert.
We believe that you had the oil flowing and the flour jar full from the widow of Nain's day.
We believe that you fed the thousands with loaves and fishes.
Now, hungry as we are, we turn again to you as we worship you this morning. Feed our souls on the living bread of Jesus. Amen.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for the little bit of clouds that we have, but we thank you that you have brought people out to share and support with our kids as they lead them in worship, that we're comfortable with the way children learn, because it's in the repetition, whether it's through song or music, videos or plays, that they really come to know so much about you. Help us to learn more about you this morning, too. Be present with us here through your Holy Spirit. We ask this in Jesus' name, and all God's kids said,
Amen.
Amen.
Manna and snail, you're right. So our first Bible story came from the Old Testament, and we learned that God provided manna and quail in the desert. By understanding that God can provide in any situation, we learned that God is great, and that was our special on Monday. So all of you guys, it's your turn to pay attention because there's going to be a quiz to the video that we're about to watch, okay?
The book of Exodus tells us that the Israelites had been in the land of Egypt for 400 years before God asked Moses and his brother Aaron to lead God's people out of Egypt and into the promised land. God performed many miracles along the way, including parting the Red Sea. But as time went on, the 15th day of the second month since they left Egypt to be exact, the Israelites began to grumble to Moses and Aaron. "Hey, it's a little warm out here. Oh, look, more sand." Actually, they were more upset than that. That guy hadn't been in the back in 2 months, and he stinks. They were really, really mad. In fact, they said, "If only we had stayed in Egypt, we could have died there and not here in the desert." Yeah, at least there were drive-thru restaurants and good Wi-Fi in Egypt. I don't think they said that. But they did grumble a lot and wish they were back in Egypt. As always, the Lord heard their grumbling and told Moses that God would provide for them. God would rain down bread from heaven. Not only did God plan to provide bread, God also planned to provide meat. In the evening, snails came and covered the entire meal. Oops, sorry. That should be quail. Quail came and covered the entire thing. It's a type of quail. In the morning, there was dew on the ground. But when the dew went away, thin flakes that looked like frost lay on the ground. The Israelites didn't know what it was, so they just called it manna, which actually means, what is it? Manna tasted like crackers and honey. To be sure God's people would follow, God gave Moses special instructions. Each day, everyone should only gather as much manna as they needed for that day. The rest of the manna would melt away as the day got hotter. Some people tried to save leftovers for the next day, but they found that it smelled bad and had worms in it. Yeah, remember? God said to only gather what would be used that day. The Israelites were to gather enough manna for each day, 5 days of the week. On the sixth day, God told them to gather twice as much manna. Since the seventh day, the Sabbath day, was holy and was to be a day of rest, they would prepare a double amount on the sixth day, eat as they normally did, and then save the leftovers for the Sabbath day. There would be no manna on the ground on the seventh day, week after week, month after month, year after year. This was how God provided for the Israelites. Although their menu didn't change for the next 40 years, God was faithful to provide their daily bread. And that's how it happened in the Bible.
Bye. work, rest, or gather twice as much manna. What were they supposed to do? Show me, which one was it? They were supposed to rest on the seventh day. That's right. Everybody, give yourself a round of applause.
Yeah. It's a part of worship. She's working on her Friday script. So, as the Israelites grumbled and growled and complained about their God, we do that too. And so, that's called sinning. And we have to confess our sins to God. So, I don't know if Matt's going to be ready. But we need to move on to prayer while you get situated. So if you would all stand, please, as you are able, and join me in this morning's prayer confession. Let's pray together. Oh God, we are hungry. We are hungry for attention. We are hungry for recognition. We are hungry for vengeance. We are hungry for love. We are hungry for experiences. We are hungry for life. But are we hungry for you? Do we hunger and thirst for your righteousness? Do we hunger for your presence? Do we hunger for your glory? Will we take you at your word? O great God, reveal yourself to us. Feed us with your bread of life. And teach us to hunger for you. Amen. We are called to seek the Lord while he may be found, call upon him while he is near. We are to forsake the wicked ways and the evil of men and their thoughts, and we are to turn to the Lord. And when we do that, then he will have mercy upon us and give us his peace, and we will find pardon for our sins. The peace of Christ be with you all. Take this moment to greet each other with the peace of Christ through a handshake, a wave, a hug, or a smile.
Thank you.
was all over the place.
It's not a deal.
Yes, it belongs. Okay, so on Tuesday, we learned about a man named Elijah. And who did God send Elijah to go see? Anybody remember? Who did Elijah go see? Stetson. A widow, that's right. So she lived all alone. And her husband had died. And she only had a little bit of what?
Oil.
Oil, that's right, Jack. And how was she supposed to make bread for Elijah if she only had a little bit of oil? What happened? What did God do? What did God do, Stetson? That's right, so the widow gave everything that she had to Elijah, and once she did that, God gave her so much more. He gave her all that she could have ever needed, plus some, right? So that's what we learned on day two, on Tuesday. We're going to skip to Thursday's lesson. Can you guys remember Thursday? That was when Jesus saw the crowd of people. And what were the people? Were they hot and sweaty? Probably. They were hungry. You're right, Jack. So how was Jesus going to feed these people? He found a small lunch from who? From a little boy. That's right. So everybody back in your seats, we're going to learn about our lesson from Thursday about Jesus feeding all those people.
The Bible tells us that when Jesus was in town, people took notice. He frequently attracted a crowd of people who wanted to see what he would do next. Although not everyone believed that Jesus was the Son of God, they could have denied that his miracles were supernatural. John chapter 6 tells us about one of them. Supernatural lunch. One day, Jesus and his disciples crossed the Galilee Sea and walked up a mountain. They weren't alone, however. As Jesus looked up, he saw a large crowd coming toward him. I said a large crowd came toward him. It was more like 5,000 men, plus women and children. So that meant there were a lot of people. Jesus was a great host, however. He didn't want any of his guests to be hungry.
Jesus didn't have a personal chef to cater, however.
So he turned to one of his disciples, Philip, and asked him, "Where should we buy food to feed this crowd?" Really, Jesus already knew how he was going to feed the crowd. He simply wanted to test Philip. Philip tried to quickly add up the cost of feeding the large crowd. He said, "Even if there was a food truck parked right there, it would take half a year's salary to pay for enough food for all these people." While Philip was still thinking about the cost, Andrew went searching for whatever food he could find. Surely someone had packed a sandwich for a whole bar or even a breath mint. Although he didn't find any of those things, he did find a small lunch brought by one of the children. Did I mention that it was a small lunch? It was only 5 small pieces of bread and 2 little fish. What good is that for a crowd this big? This is when Jesus launched Operation Feed the Crowd. It was one of the earliest outdoor potluck lunches ever. The only thing on the menu was bread and fish. Of course, 5 small loaves of bread and 2 little fish wasn't enough food for 5,000 men, plus women and children. But in the hands of Jesus, miracles happen. And wow, did it happen on this day. Jesus took the food and thanked God. Then he passed around the food so everyone could get as much as they wanted. Some people in the back were probably getting a little nervous, but when Jesus caters an event, you never run out of good food. In fact, when everyone had they wanted to eat, Jesus bust the tables. No, I said they bust the tables. That means they cleaned up after everybody did a week. So the disciples picked up all that was left over, and they had 12 full baskets of food left over. Jesus turned the vision of food into multiplication of food. It was a fantastic miracle that reminds us that even when a little is given to God, it can grow much more than we could ever imagine. And that's how it happened in heaven.
Now we're gonna need really turn it up.
5, 6, 7, here we go. Oh, thank you. Nice. Just up and down too late one day. They were hanging on every word he'd say. But later he'd gone to the top of your body. You can hear the music in that song.
Which is going to feed who? Does anybody remember? Carmen, who was on the No, not the people in Ukraine. Who is it? Kids from here that don't have food. That's kids that we go to school with. Kids that we meet on the playground. Kids that we swim with in the swimming pool. Kids that go to our daycare. This is enough to feed just about 5,000 families. Can you imagine that? We did that all ourselves. Congratulations, guys. Good job. All right, Jack, you guys brought in $287.34. While you're up, pop that blue balloon right there. One, two, three. Woo! Does that one have the right one in it? The total? No? Doesn't. I got it right here. Okay, Jack, then you just come up here and you read this. This was our total offering with our banks, our loose offering from every day. And what is it, Jack?
The counter is just a bank, wouldn't appreciate that. But we took all of that change, and then it was counted by a wonderful counting team of Chuck Sturiel and John Lamort and Emily and me, and then a special team of parents hired from Funk and Wagnalls, and it was all hermetically sealed and put into the closet. And it was all great, but we wouldn't have had anything if it hadn't been our kids encouraging you and you encouraging the kids. I know some of these kids took their piggy banks and dumped them into the box. And that's heartwarming to me. I know some of these kids have money that they can spend that they've gotten from birthdays or whatever, and they could buy whatever they wanted. And they put it in the box. They didn't wait for your console or your sofa or your dryer. It came from them and it came from their heart, and they were touched enough to give. And so we were blessed in that. So as we look back over the week, we have a lot to be thankful for. We have, first and foremost, the backing of this church. Bible school wouldn't happen if it wasn't for Bethel here. I know other churches that have foregone Bible school this year. They're not going to do it. How do our children learn when there's no Bible school? We are thankful. More than Bethel, we're thankful to God for the days of sunshine and rain and the safety that he gave us. We're blessed by the many volunteers. If you look on the back of your bulletin, those are the list of volunteers, people who signed on from the beginning and people who came on board as time went on. There's more than 30 people there. 30 people, that's 40 kids, 30 people. That's almost one per child. We are blessed with volunteers who showed up in our time of need to provide leadership and friendship and fun as they shared the word, and who came when the well ran low or when the toilet backed up. You know, these things happen. God does that to keep us on our toes during Bible school. But whatever our need was, God provided. Just like he provided in all the stories the kids learned about today. You know, there's a term for God, and it's Jehovah Jireh. Jehovah Jireh means our God provides, and we learned that this week. And so we were blessed to be a blessing to our kids and to their families, and we're thankful to all of you for your generosity on behalf of our mission project. We were totally blown away. It's awesome. Let's just say a quick prayer over everything that happened, over the proceeds that we collected. Father, we thank you for the givingness of the people that we serve this week. We thank you that you blessed our efforts. But the true blessing will come down the road when our kids grow up to be people of faith, when they in turn teach their children about your son, Jesus Christ. That's the biggest blessing of all. Help us to continue to reach out to our community, to our state, and indeed to our world as we share the light of Christ to all those who live in a dark place. And we say this in Jesus' name, and all God's people said in a loud voice, you weren't here for Bible school, but we put Bible school into a picture show. Matt, are you ready? Okay, everybody watch up front, and you'll get to see a little bit, and maybe you'll see yourself.